us prepare our hearts to worship the King of Kings. Can you believe we get the privilege of worshiping the creator of the earth? Every little detail in his breath, he gave birth to the birds in the sky and the plants in the ground. Please just take a moment and look around. The one who so carefully created the sun to shine. He is yours and he is absolutely mine. That very same God is right here in our presence. Breathe him in and take in his pure essence. Fill your lungs with his air. Please rise out of your chair. Take this moment to worship the King. We bring these praises as an offering. As a group, we exalt you, Lord Almighty. Let your light shine oh so brightly. Jesus is here. Jesus is here. We have nothing to fear because Jesus is here.
Well, good morning, Gateway Church. Hey, you ready to worship Jesus this morning? Come on.
I was walking the wayside, lost on a lonely road. I was chasing the high life, satisfy my soul. All the lies I believed in left me crying like the rain. Then I saw lightning from heaven and I never been the same. I'm gonna climb a mountain, I'm gonna shout about it.
Well, good morning. Is the blood flowing yet? I hope so. Well, hey, we're here to worship Jesus. I know we can celebrate a lot of things in life. We can celebrate the ups, we can celebrate downs, we can celebrate all kinds of things, but one thing that I know who is worthy, and his name is Jesus Christ, and all that he's given to us. So come on, let's sing with everything we've got. Let's raise a hallelujah in this place this morning.
I'll raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah. My way is a melody. I'll raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
Alive. praise, God. There's no one like you. No one like your name. There's no one more powerful, God. No one greater, God. No one that loves us more, God. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Heaven without us. Jesus. seas into highways. You're the only one who can
do that again. You turn graves.
You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can.
Come on, give Jesus praise. He's worthy of all of our praise. We sing your praises. Come on, shout out to the name of Jesus. Come on. We love you, Jesus. So, Father, in your presence is where we find peace. It's where we find joy. So, God, we ask that your peace and your joy would flood into our lives as we fix our eyes and our thoughts, our gaze turns to you, Jesus Christ. Thank you that in this moment, everything else just seems to melt away. And where we may experience sadness and where we may be experiencing defeat or failure, you stare at us and you see victorious ones in you by your power, by your grace, by your mercy. You love us. Thank you for this opportunity to worship you, God. It is an honor. As one voice, as one body, as one family, we declare our love of the mighty one, Jesus Christ. Beautiful name, wonderful name, powerful name. The name like no other name. The name of Jesus. Church, would you just begin to speak the name of Jesus? Jesus, we love you. Jesus, we come on, church, let me hear your voices as you just declare your love for Jesus right now. We love you, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. No, I was thinking, with every head bowed and with every eyes closed right now, there's been something that shifted in your heart this morning as you came walking in. You were feeling heavy, you were feeling burdened, you were feeling down. And as we've been singing the name of Jesus, there's been a pull by the Spirit of the living God upon you. And he's saying, come to me, all you who are weary, all you who need rest. And he's inviting you right here, right now, to come to his arms. Maybe you've been doing it for years. You've been running to Jesus. But I believe that there's some this morning that in this time of worship, some of you, you have yet to say, I want Jesus to be my King. I want him to be my Lord and Savior. And the Bible says that all we must do is confess and believe. Confess and believe. Believe and confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, and you will be saved. So with nobody looking around, this is between you and the Lord right now. If you would like to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, would you just raise your hand and allow the Lord to just see you and experience you and know what your decision is. Come on, don't wait for another moment. Don't wait for another day. But if you would say, I want Jesus Christ to be my Lord and Savior. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the move of your Spirit right now. Jesus, we love you. God, we pray for these. That would say, I need Jesus to be my Lord and Savior. That God, would we confess with our mouth that you are the Lord. That we believe in our heart that God, you will forgive us of all of our sin. Every mistake, every wrongdoing, everything that we've ever thought. You wash it all away. And you see us brand new in you. So God, would you look upon your people right now, brand new in you, in worship and in praise. Thank you, God, for this opportunity. In Jesus' mighty, mighty name. Amen, amen, amen. Come on, can we give the Lord one more clap of praise? What an honor it is to have you with us this morning, worshiping with us. If you've been online, join us. Thank you so much for joining us. But hey, we're going to do something right now. If you're new in the house, we've got a pumpkin that we'd like to get in your hand. We'd like to find out who you are. And so I want to encourage you to get back to the back table, and we'd love to introduce ourselves and you introduce yourself to us as well. But the rest of you, would you just be one big happy family? High five each other, hug each other, unless they're sick, and then you stay away from them. But love somebody in Jesus' name. Middle schoolers and high schoolers, if you guys haven't gone yet, you can go. And we've been doing a new thing with elementary. If you guys haven't been dismissed yet, you guys can head back to your class as well.
Morning. Oh, that's good. So I'm up here today to raise awareness for this month. Does anybody know what October is? Pastor Appreciation Month and Breast Cancer Awareness. Yeah, that was a good one. I didn't expect that. So today I have the privilege of coming up here and just kind of getting to share some ways that we can appreciate the pastors in this church. We have four pastors that currently serve at the church on staff, and that would be Lynn, Aaron, Stacy, and Greg. Yeah. Oh, nice. Yeah. So we're going to have some thank you cards, and I'm going to put them over here on the yes wall. And if you guys could just take a couple minutes to leave the pastors a note and just share with them something in a way that maybe they touched your guys' lives recently. I think now is a really good time to remind people of the good things that they've done in our lives. Yeah. And if you want to drop off any gifts, there's also the bucket's going to be over there. You can put cash, or we're going to be doing this for the next 2 weeks until October's over. So if you want to get a gift card this week or something and throw it in the bucket and let them know how much you care, that'd be awesome. You can also bring anything by the church, flowers. I've just seen some people have reached out and asked what ways can we show that we appreciate. So that's another way. You could also drop stuff off at Stacy's house. We're going to post her address. No, okay. No, we're not doing that. No, I'm just going to say a blessing over our pastors. I don't see Greg. Where is Greg? Oh, he's back there in the light. Can we just all stand real quick? And I'm going to say a blessing over our pastors. If you're near a pastor, Lynn's up front here. Can you just reach out and maybe put a hand on them? And I'm just going to say a blessing. Father, we just thank you right now for a time like this, that you would raise up leaders that could just steward this church, Father, steward our hearts as we follow them. And we just thank you for their guidance. I just ask that you would protect them right now as their ministry is moving forward, Father. We just feel that this church is being built up for something great. And we just thank you that you would refresh them, that you would just bless the years that they have, Father, that they would continue to move forward in your power. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Thank you, Caden. Thank you so much. And real quickly, it does happen to be one pastor's birthday today. So, Pastor Greg, happy birthday to you. You can all pinch him on your way out today. Is that good? I gave you permission. Hey, I want to acknowledge six other licensed Foursquare pastors. Did you know that Gateway has six other pastors? Some of them have retired from vocational ministry, but you know what? They have not retired from ministry, okay? And so they bless the strength and the foundation of this church is due in part because of their investment, their leadership, their purposeful pastoring. Because once a pastor, always a pastor, right? It's a spiritual gifting, right? To be a pastor, that just means you care for people. And these people care for people well. So when I call your name, will you stand up, please? Andrea Diaz. And Rick Barber. Sandy Vandegrift, if you're here today. Foch and Debbie Fuller. And Aaron Fuller is in the sound booth today. And we just want to say, would you give them a round of applause? We appreciate your service and your investment in the kingdom long term, and so blessed to have you in our midst at Gateway now. So bless you today on Pastor Appreciation Month. Two quick announcements. We have a ministry called Alpha. It's called the Alpha Course. And as a part of that course, we do an Alpha Weekend. We do a one-day intensive on the Holy Spirit. And we'll be watching videos. Who is the Holy Spirit? What does the Holy Spirit do? How can I be filled with the Holy Spirit? If you have questions about the Holy Spirit, even if you haven't participated in Alpha, we want to invite you. It's October 28th from 9 in the morning till 4 in the afternoon. You are invited. If you have done an Alpha course and you weren't able to come to the Holy Spirit weekend, please, you can sign up online or in the cafe. We want to expose our whole church body to the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen? And so please join us that day if you want to learn more. Finally, we have our trunk or treat coming up on Halloween, October 31st. We are going to fill that front parking lot with cars, with their trunks opened. Sometimes people decorate their trunks. They dress up in costumes. It is a blast. So if you want to sign up for a spot, please do so in the cafe. But we also need candy. So would you please bring any, you know, I mean, it's everywhere. You walk through the store and you can't miss it. Would you pick up a couple bags and bring them to the cafe? Because we could use a lot of candy to bless our neighborhood. Amen? Bless you today.
Y'all. Glad you're here this morning. I have to bring a chair up because I'm 55 now, so I got to sit, you know. It's a little unnerving when I'm starting to get emails from AARP. My name's Greg. I'm one of the guys on the team. What a joy to get to serve you and share some scripture with you. If you have your Bibles, we're going to be in the Old Testament book of Judges. It's the seventh book in the OT. We're going to be getting into chapter 3 here in just a minute. But for my birthday, I asked the team to, is there any possibility for having the drums? We haven't had the drums since Easter. And we're going to start passing out earplugs from here on out. But I know I'm getting old when it's like, wow, that was cracking. That was something else. So thank you, worship team. One of the other pastors that wasn't mentioned specifically so that I could is that we do have an amazing team with Stacy and with Aaron and with Lynn and all those that were mentioned. But the oldest pastor in the room is a pastor that's been a pastor to me and is the reason I'm probably a pastor today, serving for nearly 50 years as a pastor in Four Square, in Eugene, in Salem, in San Diego, in Seattle, and all up and down the whole West Coast. My 86-year-old father, Pastor John. So happy Pastor Appreciation Day to you. And in honor of my pops, if you've been around my dad very long, you know that he's a prayer, but he's also a singer, and he sings his prayers. And I know we raised a hallelujah, and I know we got a little bit louder, and then we got shouting, and so strong, so good. But for all of us over the age of 55, would you just join me in something a little sweet as we just kind of ready our hearts for the scripture today? Go something like this. Maybe you've heard it before, and because it's my birthday, I'm just going to sing it because I've been asked not to ever sing it, but it goes something like this. You just give praise to Jesus today. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice, take joy, my King, in what you hear, let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ears. Jesus, we thank you that we can praise you. In the safety of this space, we can praise, we can pray, we can rejoice, we can shout. We can be soft and we can be loud and we can be drums and we can be a cappella. We can love you. And we thank you that we are your beloved. So today, would you speak through the Holy Scriptures? May this Old Testament passage come alive and off the page. So we trust you today. We give you thanks. In your precious and powerful name, amen. All right, I'm double mic'd today. Let's go. Get ready to rumble. Let's go, Carlos. Let's turn on those house lights so I can see those good-looking people out there, and you can see your good-looking scriptures this morning. You had plenty of time to find Judges. Man, if you're new to Gateway, make sure to get a pumpkin today if you're a first-time guest, and I sure would enjoy a high-five or a hug as you exit today. I'll try to be back there at the end, but if you're checking out churches, this is a place that's grace-given, kingdom-living, learning to be forgiven, Bible-believing, wanting to walk in the mercies that are new and the grace that's sufficient, that we would know him personally, that we would know each other personally, that we grow in him and in the word so that we can go passionately. Around here, we call it the no-grow-go. And so if you're checking out churches this morning, that's us. And we appreciate you giving us a shot. There's a lot of great churches here in the Willamette Valley, but thank you for coming this morning. We're in a series called Warrior Up. We are looking at different judges. Gideon, last week, man, Aaron did a great job. Giddy up with Gideon. And then this week, a new guy. And then next week, Stacy brings Deborah to us. That's going to be strong. And then we finish with Samson. So October is going to be a great month as we're learning to warrior up. Messy people, merciful God. Just nudge your neighbor and just remind them, hey, you're messy. You are messy. You are messy. Some of you wives gave your husbands a little extra oomph there on that one. How many of you are grateful today that we can be messy, but we have a Messiah who's merciful to be able to help us out of our mess? That his grace is sufficient, and he can help us to be able to move forward and to press on. And so we've got that courageous lion as our theme.
because we're not Wizard of Oz, not courageous lions. We are courageous. We are bold lions who are learning to warrior up. This message comes to you brought by the movie standards of a G general audience. Nope, PG. The only thing PG about this is Pastor Greg, because this is not parental guidance. In fact, it's not even PG-13. This is some R-rated stuff. So if you have your kids in here, this is your time. If you want them to get some rated R right here, stay. But the nursery's open, and the Children's Kingdom Kids is happening. So today we're going to get down and get dirty in Judges. It says in Judges is one of the kind of theme verses. In those days, there was no king in Israel, but every man did that which was right in his own eyes. As you begin to think and judge Israel for their inabilities and for their mess, let it come a little bit closer to home, because we also do whatever is right in our own eyes. We justify and validate and make excuses for the decisions sometimes that we make, and we just do things that we think is right in our own eyes when it's actually pretty wrong. Or maybe it's not wrong, but it's just not right. And we got to get back to right living, because that's what righteousness is. In those days, there was no king in Israel. In these days, in 2023, there might be different kings, presidents, emperors, and leaders. But we must take personal responsibility and ownership and not do the things that are right in our own eyes, but the things that are right in his eyes. Nudge your neighbor, say amen to that. So here's a quick recap leading up to Judges chapter 3. Chapter 3 is where we're going to be here in just a moment, but let me just help us today with, in Judges chapter 1, you got Israel fighting the remaining Canaanites. You got Joshua as the captain. He's leading. He's the general, and he's leading the charge. They're taking down the Canaanites. They're doing their business. And then Judges chapter 2, you have this great sighting of the angel of the Lord at Bochim, and they have this moment where they're just having a little bit of a come to Jesus time, but they don't respond well in Judges chapter 2. And they respond to disobedience and defeat, and then you're going to see Joshua's going to die at the young age of 110 years old. So this is Judges 1 and 2, which lead to 3, and where we're going to be today. And in Judges chapter 3, here come the judges. Here come the judges, because there were not kings yet. So we have people that are raised up called judges. And this morning, is this might be new to you. In the Old Testament, God uses a lot of different things. He can use a donkey that can speak. He can use judges to lead. He can use kings. He can use creation. He can use, even the rocks will cry out. I mean, he can use a lot of things, but we're going to learn here about the judges. Showing you up on the screen that there's 12 judges in Israel. So here's just the history of it. This is real, true, blue, living stuff. Back in history, there's 12 of them. I don't know if you could read. It starts with Othniel. And then we have our character today, Ehud. And it's going to end with Samson. Samson, we know, long hair, strong. No hair, not strong. And we know that Samson, by the time we get to Samson, I mean, this is one messed up dude. But God called and he equipped these particular judges to rule and reign, if you will, and to lead the people of Israel. Now, what's interesting with these different judges is that they don't come all from one location geographically. Let me show you on the map that all 12 of the judges represented all 12 tribes, all 12 areas in the region of Israel. And so this morning, as we get into it and we learn more about these civil leaders, these tribal chieftains, these ones that are providing leadership and direction, whether it's Gideon, Ehud, Deborah or Samson or the others, there's some things to learn from these particular characters for us today. But in chapter 3, where we're going to be today, up on the screen you'll see in verse 7, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. They forgot the Lord, their God. Now, this is then when Othniel will come on scene. They've been in years of oppression. Othniel will come on scene, and he'll be able to push back, because they're going to ask for forgiveness. They're going to come out of their sin cycle. And then Othniel's going to show up. He's going to judge some things, and he's going to get them back to a time of peace. So you have a time of peace, but now go 5 verses down in chapter 3. Only 5 verses down in the same chapter 3. And we see, again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. You see, the judges is rated R because there's going to be some things that are radically done that we don't want to even repeat here in 2023. And so there's some lessons to learn. And again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. And this might sound familiar in your camp, in your tribe, in your family, in your home, in your line. but may it be a breaking of the cycle, and that the Israelites who again and again and again did evil in the eyes of the Lord, that in the Schaub house and in the house and the Thompson house and the Morellis house and the Booker house and the Diaz house and the Fuller house, that there would not be said of us, and again they did evil in the eyes of the Lord, but that we would break the cycle of sin and we'd be able to believe that we have a judge and his name is Jesus. And he comes to offer himself as a sacrifice. But here we see in Judges chapter 3 that they needed judges. And where we're going to be today is in chapter 3, verse 12 through 30. Now, because it's my birthday today, I'm going to take some liberties. And the first one, is that I'm going to read all of these. This one? Or this one? Should I take this off? Today we're going to read all 18 verses. I'm not used to holding the microphone, so we'll see if we can do a couple things at once today. Happy birthday today. We do not have these verses up on the screen. You got to open your Bibles. So get your smart devices and get them ready. Judges is right after Joshua, before Samuel. And we're going to be in chapter 3. I'm going to restart at verse 12. Here comes Ehud. All right. Oh, Lord God, speak through this today. Once again, the Israelites did evil in the Lord's sight, and the Lord gave King Eglon of Moab control over Israel because of the evil. Eglon enlisted the Ammonites and Amalekites as allies, and then he went out and defeated Israel, taking possession of Jericho, the city of palms. And the Israelites served Eglon and Moab for 18 years. Pause. 18 years of oppression, persecution, suffering. Not good stuff. But verse 15 says, but when the people of Israel cried out to the Lord for help, and by the way, why does it take 18 years to cry out for help? It shouldn't take 18 days. It shouldn't take 18 minutes. We should be 18 seconds, and Lord, I'm crying out for help. But when the people of Israel cried out to the Lord for help, the Lord again raised up a rescuer to save them. And his name was Ehud, son of Gera, a left-handed man of the tribe of Benjamin. And the Israelites sent Ehud to deliver their tribute money to King Eglon of Moab. So Ehud made a double-edged dagger that was about a foot long, a cubit, 18 inches, and he strapped it to his right thigh, keeping it hid under his clothing. And he brought the tribute money to Eglon, who was... Now, this is the only time in the Bible that it really says this, and I'm only going to read it because it's in here, but he calls this guy fat. And in my version, New Living Translation, he brought the tribute money to Eglon, who was very fat. And after delivering the payment, Ehud started home with those who had helped carry the tribute. But when Ehud reached the stone idols near Gilgal, he turned back and he came to Eglon and said, I have a secret message for you. So the king commanded his servants, be quiet. And he sent them all out of the room. Verse 20, Ehud walked over to Eglon, who was sitting alone in a cool upstairs room, and Ehud said, I have a message from God for you. And as King Eglon rose from his seat, this is where it's about to get rated R. Catch your breath. This is the word of God. Ehud reached with his left hand and pulled out the dagger strapped to his right thigh, and he plunged it into the king's belly. And the dagger went so deep that the handle disappeared beneath the king's fat. So Ehud did not pull out the dagger, and the king's bowels emptied. And then Ehud closed and locked the doors of the room and escaped down the latrine. Pastor Greg, why are you talking about Ehud on your birthday? Verse 24, there's just a few more. After Ehud was gone, the king's servants returned and found the doors to the upstairs room locked. Some would say it was like a glorified bathroom. They found the doors to the upstairs room locked, and they thought he might be using the latrine in the room, so they waited. But when the king didn't come out after a long delay, they became concerned and got a key. And when they opened the doors, they found their master dead on the floor. How are we doing, everybody? We okay? We just a few more. Verse 26, while the servants were waiting, Ehud escaped, passing the stone idols on his way to Sarah. When he arrived in the hill country of Ephraim, Ehud sounded a call to arms. And then he led a band of Israelites down from the hills. Follow me, he said, for the Lord has given you victory over Moab, your enemy. So they followed him, and the Israelites took control of the shallow crossings of the Jordan River across from Moab, preventing anyone from crossing. They attacked the Moabites and killed about 10,000 of their strongest and most able-bodied warriors. Not one of them escaped. And our final verse today, so Moab was conquered by Israel that day, and there was peace in the land for how many years? 80 years. This is the word of the Lord, and as rated R as it might sound, there are some lessons from this judge, Ehud, that we can apply for our lives today. I'm not saying that we need to strap on daggers, and certainly not to call people very fat, but there are some things that we can learn of a messy situation with messy people and how the mercifulness of God comes in and saves the people of Israel. And so this morning, I trust that we would understand that God relentlessly offers his grace to his people who do not deserve it, who don't seek it and don't appreciate it even after they receive it. And yet we are his children. We are his beloved. We are the apple of his eye. We are his kids. And he loves us enough to pour out his grace upon us. And yet you may be saying, well, where's the grace in Judges chapter 3? Like, where is it? Let me work through some of the Hebrew and some of the names and some of the language that's going on here, and then I'll bring some observations, and then I'll close with an application, and then we're going to sing another big song that may require earphones. But this Ehud in the Hebrew, his name is I will give thanks, or I will be praised, or he that praises. Now, around here at Gateway, if you've been here for more than 6 months, you know that we believe and find names to be pretty significant. And so I bring to you the actual meaning of Ehud, because Ehud, or Ehud, there's lots of different ways to say it, but let's just, for today, I'm just going to call him Ehud. It just sounds a little more warrior-y like that. Ehud. I will give thanks, I will be praised. He's a Benjamite judge of Israel. He's a deliverer of the oppression from Moab, and he is a left-handed warrior. Now, it's what's interesting here in this story is that left-handed people back in Israel times would have been considered handicapped people. So let me see all the handicapped. I mean, I didn't mean to say it like that. Let me see all the southpaws out there. Let's see the southpaws. Leave your hands up. Let me see those southpaws. Nice. Only 10 to 13% of people in the world are left-handed. So it's not a large group, and we know that more men than women are left-handed. And we know if you're familiar with Mensa, which is the brainiacs, the smart people, 20% of Mensa people are left-handed. So nowadays, we wouldn't consider it a handicap. We'd probably consider it as southpaws are smarter. But left-handers would be people that would be considered to have a handicap and looked down upon. And it's interesting the level of detail that we're going to find in Judges chapter 3. I mean, we got very fat, we got daggers, we got a cubit long, we got very specific stuff, and we got a left-handed judge. And why all this detail? Why all this stuff for us? Well, in verse 16, before Ehud, he went on this journey, he made himself a double-edged dagger, 18 inches long, and he hid it in his clothing, strapped against his right thigh. That's what the Living Bible says. Now, a dagger, just so you're clear here, in the Hebrew is hereb, and it's that Ehud made one that's two-edged, not one-edged. And it's 18 inches in length, and he hid it under his raiment or his garment. Now, I actually, for my birthday, got myself a little Damascus steel. And so we're going to see that in this story, It's on the right thigh, but he's left-handed, and he takes this thing out, and when Eglon is not even paying attention, he takes care of business with the 18-inch, the cubit long, and a cubit is basically from elbow to knuckles, and that's about what this is, and this is a two-edger. I better put it away before somebody gets hurt. But an 18-inch gomed, this 18 inches long, and he does something with it that I don't want to suggest that we do to people, but there's a lot of symbolism from all the details in this story. Let me try to explain it to us this way. Ehud goes back, and he takes care of Eglon. Eglon is the king. He's very fat. That's all we know about him. He's probably relieving himself in the upper room. And somehow, Ehud gets this audience with the king. And he goes to give a tribute. And a tribute was something that he brought every year because Eglon ruled and reigned for 18 years. So they brought a tribute of either money or wheat or wool or some kind of tribute to the king every year. But why after 18 years does this change? Why after 18 years do we see an 18-incher show up? Why after 18 years would Ehud turn back in his tracks and say, enough is enough? And I want to submit this first idea to you today, that until you cut off the source, you will always be slave to the sin. And I'm holding this up because, yes, it's daggery and sharp, and it's impressive, but it's also intensely intimidating. Is that this is something we can learn from Ehud's example, that we've got to stop feeding it. We've got to stop investing in it. We've got to stop dabbling in it. We got to stop watching it. Until you cut off the source, you will always be slave to the sin. And let it start sinking in, my brothers and sisters, that there's something that needs to be eradicated, removed from our life. And it is sin. And the thing that we learn from Judges is that there's some stuff that can be cut out. And it can be cut out not with a dagger, not with a two-edged sword, but why not? What else is double-edged to? Oh, well, look at that.
Which one is sharper? You don't need to carry a dagger on your right thigh when you hold the precious, powerful word of God in your right hand. And when you get into this, woo, things start getting pretty sharp. You can be in 18 years of oppression, but then call out on the Lord and see a word that's so sharp that it adjusts things in your life to be able to root out sin, cut out sin. Stop dabbling with pornography. Stop going online to that spot. Stop investing in that bad habit. Break that addiction. Come on, heartache and hardship and hurts and all the things that we kind of just live with for 18 years. Just live with it. And I'm suggesting today, through the example of Ehud, that we cut off some things. And that we stick this where it needs to be stuck. And I'm saying that means we got to be men and women of the Word. Because I think Ehud had this reaction or response. Enough is enough. 18 years of taking tribute to the king. 18 years to go from Jericho, from Gilgal to Jericho. Back and forth, 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 back and forth. 18 years. But it's interesting in verse 17 that we see all of a sudden out of the blue comes this new detail. That Eglon, the king, who is very fat, and Eglon, let me tell you what Eglon's name means. What did Ehud's name mean? Anybody remember? To bring him high praise? Okay, Eglon, Egl means calf. And the on, when you put it on it, would be young. So Eglon's name means young calf. There's a sacrifice that's about to take place. Moab, the one's going to bring high praise, is about to sacrifice the fatted calf.
He's about to actually take down the real name of what Eglon is, and he's saying, enough is enough. We're done with this. We're not going to bring tribute to you anymore. I have a message from God, and it's that we're done serving this sin, serving under this oppression, serving under this persecution. 18. I spent a lot of time this last week looking specifically at the numbers. Now, maybe it's because I turned 55 this week. So I'm looking at numbers, and somebody said as I came in today, 55 is double grace. So I'm taking that. Grace for five, put two fives together, you get double grace. But 18, back to the story. The years of oppression, the length of the dagger. I don't think that there's a mistake when it comes to some of the symbolism and the significance of Scripture with numbers and with meaning. And we today, friends, have a double-edged sword that we need to declare a whole lot more often. But it means we got to take it into some dangerous places. We got to be willing to be able to take it into some messy latrines, be able to take it into some spots where the king who has been oppressing us and causing persecution in us, we could say, no more. No more. This is how strong this can be in our lives. We have this double-edged sword. Let me show you in Scripture, in Hebrews 4:12, notice this. On the screen, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. I'm not making this kind of stuff up. I mean, this is Old Testament. You got Ehud in the double edge. And then you got Hebrews in the New Testament with the word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword. So good. But let me tell you about another number. And the number is 11. And 11 is the miles from Gilgal to Jericho. And why does that matter? Okay, so you saw in the story that they went to Jericho, the city of palms, where Moab the king was. But then they returned to Gilgal. And if you know your Bible history, Gilgal is a special place. But in Gilgal, 11 miles from Jericho, and you're walking this, you're not lifting, Ubering, taxiing, or training this, that is a pretty good walk. And Ehud, who sent them on, is also actually with them. And Ehud, in the middle of this, when he gets to Gilgal, he then has this revelation, epiphany, something's going on in his life where he's like, wait a minute, we're in Gilgal, and I see these living stones, I see these stones, I see these memorials. What's he seeing? Perhaps scholars would say that when Joshua, who just a book prior, crossed over the Jordan River, put 12 stones and built them in the middle of the river, right, as a memorial. And we see that in Joshua, let me just read it to you, in Joshua 4, and Joshua set up at Gilgal the 12 stones they had taken out of the Jordan. He said to the Israelites, in the future, and how many knew it was going to be this fast? He said to the Israelites, in the future, when your descendants ask their parents, what do these stones mean? Tell them Israel crossed the Jordan on dry ground. And I would go as far to say that Ehud with his traveling mates who were returning home to another year of oppression, that Ehud sees the stones and is reminded of God's faithfulness, reminded of the promises, reminded of the possibilities, and Ehud says, enough is enough. You go on home and I'm going back. And he then returns solo back to take care of the business. I wonder today if we're willing to make the 11-mile journey back. I wonder if we're willing to be able to go back into the things that haven't been cut off or struck down or taken out of our lives. That we'd be willing to walk the hours, do the counseling, take care of the stuff to break off addictions, to be able to go back to where it can really be resolved. Because until you cut off the head of the snake, until you be able to cut off the source, there's just going to be sin that just continues to creep in. And Ehud reminds us that we need to find faith for the future by remembering God's faithfulness in the past. He saw it with the 12 stones when Joshua crossed over. So sometimes, may I suggest, that we actually got to look back to look forward. And what in your life have you seen and can remember and recall? Wow, God, you're so good. You're so faithful. You're so amazing. And that I would be reminded by that to help catapult me into this. Sometimes you got to go back to see that so you can then go forward to see this. Now, I'm a Philippians 3 kind of guy, so I believe that we need to forget what's behind and press on to what's ahead. But in this story, I think something happens with great revelation for Ehud, that he sees something that happened in his past that triggers and launches him into something to motivate him into his future. What is it? Is it a worship song? Is it a word? Is it a devotional? Is it a special song? What is it in your life that's going to finally hit you to remind you of his faithfulness? Wow, he's good. He's so good. Stacy and I celebrated last Sunday on October 8th, and we weren't together because she spoke at a church in Redmond, and I was at a men's retreat, so we weren't even together, but we celebrated apart our 36-year anniversary. Now, yes, of when we met. We met on October 8th, 1987. I'll never forget that day. I have it in my phone. And I always remember the day that we met in 87 on October 8th because it's a reminder of his faithfulness from back then, now going forward to the 36 years ahead. And if you look back, sometimes you're like, ooh, with regret. But sometimes when you look back to when God started some things, you are reminded of how faithful he is to continue writing out his purposes and things. And so, happy anniversary, and happy faith-filled anniversary to us from this story that we can look forward because of a guy named Ehud. Because the other number I want to finish with is this great number 80. 80. And you say, well, what's up with 80? Well, verse 30, they get out of there, he escapes, he goes back, he says, follow me. They go to the shorelines, and they take care of the borders where there's 10,000 other trained, skilled soldiers, and they take down 10,000 soldiers, so they finish the job. I mean, sometimes you got to put the dagger in the king, and you got to take off the source, but then there's a remnant, a little leftover, a little bit of some kind of, I got to take care of that too. 10,000 leftovers in this case. And so Ehud says, follow me, let's go get them. They're inspired. They're faith-filled. They're ready to go, and they take down 10,000 more. And then what does it say at the end? And the Israelites, after 18 years of oppression, experienced 80 years of peace. You see what faithfulness and obedience does? Without delayed obedience, but with instantaneous obedience, we see that Ehud and his brothers and sisters conquer the Moabites, and they'll go on to have 80 years. Now, can I just say, and this is partly why Ehud is in this series, is that no other judge will lead their people to this long a peace. There'll be years of oppression, 8 years, 18 years, 20 years, 7 years. And then most judges will then relieve their people into 40 years of peace. 40 years of peace. You'll see this more and more of the 12. 40 years of peace, 40 years. But Ehud, this time, they get 80. And it just got me thinking that sometimes you got to really be able to get bloody and do the hard work and be able to really cut some things out if you want to experience some real peace in your life. Now, if you want to keep dabbling and then you only want a couple months or years of peace, then dabble. But if you want a dagger, then do the real work. And let, not this, but let this begin to penetrate, stab, cut, and go deep into your gut so that it can then produce something that's redemptive. Oh, Lord, would you help us? Because like the children of Israel, unfortunately, after the 80 years, they're going to sin. Yeah, they're going to do it again. They're going to sin. And then they're going to be thrown into suffering, into servitude, and into subjugation. They're just going to fall back into this cycle. But then they're going to supplicate, they're going to cry out, they're going to intercede, and they're going to be saved all over again by another judge. And we just have this cycle of sin and suffering and supplication and salvation. And it's like this over and over and over again. Why can't we break the cycle and just stop sinning and move right to supplication? Or write to salvation and say, Jesus, we need you. Lord, help me today. Tomorrow on October 16th, wake up and say,
Help me today, Lord. Help me today. I mean, I got issues. Or maybe you don't, but your kids do. Or your boss or your neighbors do. But that we would break the sin cycle and we call out for the Lord to help us. Because he doesn't want us to wait 18 years. I think that there can be years of peace and years of salvation in front of us. This morning, speaking of peace, I'd like to make a pretty strong pivot out of this story in Judges, which is about the Israelite people. And I want to exercise a little bit of liberty, and I want you to trust me and stay with me. Because I am not going to make political statements, but I want to share biblical implications that are involved here, the people of Israel, from the time of Judges. Now, fast forward. And if you've watched the news in the last 2 weeks, there's some stuff going down. And this is not normal for me to stump or stand for something with such conviction. But I'm wearing my blue and white today, baby. I'm flying the flag, and I want you to know I stand with Israel. And we, as the people of God, as the Gentiles, as the Sunday people, need to stand with the Saturday people, and we need to stand with our Jewish brothers and sisters, and not with revenge or not with any kind of oppositional way, but that we would pray, as it says in Psalm 122, to do. And so we're going to do it. We're going to pray. Now, maybe you already have. I've been praying. I've been processing. I've been thinking about this because no time in history has been this bloody, this gross, this judge-like until maybe back to the Judges or Holocaust or some other times. But the Jewish people and Jerusalem needs our prayers. It says in Psalm 122, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May those who love you be at peace. So I'm going to ask you to do something. And this is not a political thing. This is a biblical thing. This is not, you're not making a statement on one side or the other. This isn't Republican or Democrat. This is as God's people. All right? The Jews are his chosen ones, and we have been ushered in with grace by Jesus and what was accomplished on the cross to be able to pray and to believe for peace. And in the Middle East, which is so far away over there, you might not know what's really going on down there. But there's a lot happening that we need to be aware. So I'm going to have you turn to your neighbor. And would you stand? Not stand up necessarily, but just stand in prayer together with each other. Two, three, groups of two or three. Just take 1 minute and let's pray for the peace of Israel. Mighty God, we lift our voices and our prayers, asking for the peace of Jerusalem on both sides, everywhere, that you would touch and bring peace and provision, help, 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 like only you can do. Oh, we pray that in your precious and powerful name. As the team comes and begins to lead us out of here, and just before that, I want to just share with you, because I can tell that some people are, yeah, I've been watching the news or I've been tracking with all this, but then there's some of those others that are like, I have no idea what you're talking about right now. And I don't want to stir up anything that needs to be stirred up for stirring up's sake, but I do believe that as believers, as Christ followers, there's some things we need to be stirred toward,
because there are major biblical implications of what's happening on the other side of the world. You see, it was during this time of Simchat Torah, which is the rejoicing of the Torah. It's when the Hamas terrorist knew that the Jewish people would be enjoying Shabbat Shalom. They would be enjoying this festival. This is the festival of rejoicing over the Torah. They are giving praise for the scrolls. They're rejoicing over the Word of God. They're giving thanks for the Holy Scriptures. And on the final day when they're reading these scriptures and the kids are eating candied apples and it's a big, wonderful celebration, we see Hamas terrorists paraglide in with machine guns. We see babies beheaded. We see women raped and pillaged. We see horrible, demonic activity taking place. And we've not seen this in 50 years. So it's quite intentional, by the way, that the Hamas people, on the 50-year anniversary of Yom Kippur, would wage war and go after Israel again. And on the specifics of this date, they go in to kill and destroy. And from the comfort of our homes, watching our ducks and our beavers and eating our birthday cake and all the wonderful things that we get to do on this side of the world with all of our first world problems, we realize on the other side of the world, there's some real hitting the fan. And so what do? The bloodiest day in Israel's history. Rockets, now 4,500 to 5,000 rockets are being shot just anywhere into Israel. For perspective's sake, catch this. Since 2001, 20,000 rockets have been shot into Israel. But in the first 5 days of this war, 4,000 rockets. So this is great persecution. This is serious stuff that's taking place. Some would say it's the equivalent of 10 9/11s there. Because of the scope and because of the size. You see, when the story in the Old Testament of Judges begins to collide with our story here in 2023, things get a little bit more serious, don't they? Oh, that's a nice story about Ehud and a dagger stabbing a fat guy. What about now? What about the Hamas? What about these ISIS terrorists? Which, by the way, if you don't know, is all directed and all funded by Iran. And we need to be praying, friends, because we have more Foursquare workers, ministers, missionaries on the Gaza Strip than we do in Israel. So we have people on the inside that have been giving their lives up that are now asked to be considered staying or leaving. What do you do in this situation? And last Sunday, Israel declared formal war. So this is something serious. It's the first time since 1973 that there's been this kind of attack, this kind of persecution. And just so you know that we're fighting a real devil and we have people that are against us, the Hamas and their charter, it's this, jihad the Jews, which is basically kill the Saturday people. But if you think it's, well, that's just nice for them or that's not nice for them, the second part of their charter is jihad the world. They want to actually They want to get rid of the Sunday people. That's us. Israel is only the first target. Hamas believes in total destruction. One person that I was watching said this, we love death, this is the Hamas, we love death as much as the Jews love life. That's just sick. Elementary students are being taught how to behead teddy bears if you're in that terrorist movement. This is serious, serious stuff. Another person I was watching said that the Hamas terrorists are modern-day Nazis in different uniforms. And when Hitler did the Holocaust thing, which is horrid, what did people do? What did God's people do? Were they just stunned and just stood by? And see, Israel has this incredibly devastating history. Do you remember the story of Ruth? Such a time as this. And Haman, Esther. But Haman, he wanted to destroy everybody, but then God shows up. Hitler's wanted to do it. The Hamas wanted to do it. Will we stand by or will we warrior up?
Will we do something about it? Now, just a couple more things about this, and then we're going to conclude with a prayer, and then we're going to sing our way out of here. This is a long-standing challenge and battle. I'm going to show you a picture of Palestine versus Israel and the geography and why part of this is because of the challenges. I don't know if you can see it, but the first one there on the left is that that's Palestine had all that, but then more and more and more and more and more is taken away. And all for different political reasons and all for different ramifications. But you can see why they're pissed off. You can see why they're ticked off. You can see why there's this challenge, and you can't just put all of the blame on one side or the other. This is a simple war of one against the other. And we kind of stand here in the West Coast, American, safe. But what are we going to do about it? With this little tiny country called Israel. Look at this picture of how small Israel is in comparison. That's Israel, right in the middle of comparison to what the United States is. And in the Gaza Strip, there's 2.38 million people in this little strip. It's the most populated strip in the world. And this is where we're about to see some major rebuttal and declaration of war. I'm not standing before you to say one side or the other, other than I do stand with the blue and white. I do stand against terrorism. I do stand against the Hamas's charter. I do stand with the peace of Jerusalem. And so what do we do with all this? This long-standing history, 1948, Israel becomes a nation on May 14th. But then on May 15th, then the neighbors all start throwing rockets in and there's opposition. I mean, there's stuff that's just happening that's real, real kind of stuff. And then in 1967, you see more war and the country's still divided. And you have Egypt and Syria and Lebanon and Iraq and Jordan. They all attack Israel. So it's not like the first time, but what do? And so our leaders who need our prayers, hopefully we have a better resolve and a better resolution than what took place before, because during that 1967 in the peace conferences and what tried to take place is that they had resolution, but this is where you get the famous three no's. The famous three no's is this: no recognition, Israel doesn't exist. No peace of Israel, there will be no treaties, and no negotiation. And this is why it's so difficult, because they don't want to deal with them, and so we have this challenge. We don't even recognize them. They don't even exist. We don't want to even have a peace treaty. You see, friends, as Americans, I don't think we really understand the full opposition, because we're safe, and we're okay, and we're just dealing with our daily. When on the other side of the world, Israel, according to Tehran, is the little Satan, and America is the great Satan. And if I could just stump for just another 36 seconds, you got to know this, because I'm learning some things that have caused a stir in me, and maybe because it's like, I'm 55 and I'm alive. I can't drive 55 anymore. We've got to stand up for our brothers and sisters. Why did Obama hand deliver $1.2 billion in cash to Iran and then commit $100 billion to them? Why? To the most supportive terrorist group in the world, the Iranians. Now, of course, then Trump, he comes into office and he says, no more of that deal. We're not giving billions to Iran. And he stops the deal. Okay, well, that's a good adjustment. But then Biden picks it back up and he reinstates it and says, we're going to give $6 billion to Iran. We're going to commit this to Iran. Why do we do this, Americans? So the Church of God needs to rise up and warrior up, believing for our leaders that they'll walk in greater wisdom, that we don't give resources that we should never be given, and that we stand for peace. Because the nations against Israel, like Russia and Turkey and other places, Russia just said this last week. If America partners with Israel, then Russia's going to partner with Palestine. And I don't have time today to go into it, but in Ezekiel 38 and in Zechariah chapter 12, you got biblical implications now are starting to get stirred. Because when things start shifting in the Middle East, it's going to move us to an end times that I think we're already in the end times, but it's going to move us towards some stuff that we better be ready, American. We better be set to be able to know the Word of God and to walk out some peace in our lives. So what now, as we finish our time, would you stand to your feet this morning? Thank you for helping me unpack this a little bit, because I'm learning how to do it right in front of you, but I believe that we need to stay prayerful. Don't panic. Be prayerful. Don't panic. Stay prayerful. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. It's messy, but God is merciful. Jeremy, if you could put those prayer slide up there with how to pray, and maybe you take a picture of this because you're saying, well, how do I pray? Families, loved ones, attacks, leadership. How do we respond to the Hamas and the terrorism? And how do we lift up and pray for our leaders in Washington? I mean, how? Prayer. For the hostages to be released and the things that are going on that maybe you didn't even know about, but we would be people of prayer. So stay prayerful. Stay prayerful. The other thing I want to encourage us with is that we would stay informed. Stay aware. Now, you can watch your CNN and your Fox News and your NBCs and your ABCs and your 123s, but I want to encourage you, friends. Listen, I have found a reliable resource called All Israel News, allisrael.com. That is the news from the inside. That is the news not that's going to be thrown your way to help you see a particular perspective or angle. It is on the inside of what's happening in Israel, in the Middle East, and it's impacting us, and you can get to know real news. So stay aware and stay informed. But listen, spend more time with the Almighty than you do online. That's important. That's important. Because what can happen is we can start getting we're just turning into news watchers. Look at that. Look at that terrorism. Look at that. Look at that. Because that's actually what I think Iran is wanting the Hamas to do. They want to stir up such unpeace and unrest that it makes then Israel look bad, because now Israel is going to attack the Hamas. And in that, lives are going to be lost. And if they can discredit Israel, watch how it begins to move us towards the end times. No nation will stand with Israel, not even America. That's what it says in the Bible. But we will stand with them today. Be careful to not be stirred up by images online, but instead be stirred up by our daily fount, Jesus. Stay in the Word. Stay encouraged. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. He's on duty. God's watching. Yahweh the Almighty knows what's happening. So we should have rest in that, peace in that. Stay encouraged. Stay encouraged in this. Don't get an ulcer over it. Stay encouraged. But last, and certainly not least, would you stay tuned in to the Holy Spirit? People of God, would you stay in tune with the Holy Spirit? Listen to the words of Galatians. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. Well, that sounds familiar. And they did what was right in their own eyes. But when you walk in the Spirit, you walk in His eyes, His ways. Kingdom come, His will be done. That we would stay in tune with the Holy Spirit. Friends, I mentioned at the top of this that we are a Holy Spirit believing, miracle given, learning to be forgiven kind of group of people. But without the Holy Spirit, it's like you're daggerless. It's like you're scriptureless. It's like you don't have the comforter, the counselor, the corrector, the one to help you in this. So as we prepare to sing our way out of here, could I just plead with you? If you want to get me anything for my birthday, do not get me a Starbucks gift card. Do not get me a gift card to my favorite nursery where I like to buy plants. Do not take me out to lunch. But instead, could you lean and trust and be filled with the Holy Ghost? Because a group of people that are filled and consumed and overflowing with the Holy Spirit can handle whatever rockets come our way. We can be able to go where God's calling us to go. So the greatest gift that you could give yourself and your pastor and other people in this church is the gift of accepting and receiving the fullness of the third part of the Trinity. The Holy Spirit wants to empower you and fill you and give you peace and show you His promises and that there is a hope and a future. But you got to be filled up so you can live it out. So let's do it, friends. Let's be full of the Holy Spirit this morning. Praise God.
Love so great, Jesus in all things. I've seen the glimpse of your heart a billion years. Still I'll be singing. How can I praise you enough?
Praise the name above all names. Church, as you go today, be blessed and be filled with the Holy Spirit in Jesus' mighty name. Bless you as you go.